फ्रेंड्स, वेलकम बैक टू एगैपे व्लॉग्स। दिस इज एन ऑनलाइन गाइड फॉर नर्सेस हु आर प्रिपेयरिंग टू टेक योर एग्जाम्स। दिस इज फॉर सर्टन अ गाइड दैट विल ट्रेन यू फॉर योर नर्सेस एग्जाम एनीवेयर इन द वर्ल्ड। सो विदाउट वेस्टिंग टाइम लेट्स मूव ऑन टू द क्वेश्चंस एंड आई एडवाइस यू टू आंसर योर सेल्फ एंड ऑल्सो टू मार्क योर स्कोर्स एंड एनालाइज हाउ वेल यू हैव स्कोर्ड योर सेल्फ। ओके, लेट्स मूव ऑन। Question number 31. If a patient is experiencing dysphagia, which of the following investigations are they likely to have? Option A, colonoscopy. Option B, gastroscopy. Option C, cystoscopy. And option D, arthroscopy. The question was too simple. The patient here was experiencing dysphagia. Dysphagia is nothing but difficulty swallowing. So the right answer will be option B, that is gastroscopy. We had other options like colonoscopy. Colonoscopy is an exam to detect changes or abnormalities in the large intestine, that is the colon and the rectum. And we also had cystoscopy, which is a procedure that allows your doctor to examine the lining of your bladder and the tube that carries urine out of your body, that is the urethra. And we also had arthroscopy, which is a procedure for diagnosing and treating joint problems. The right option was gastroscopy. I hope all of you have got it right. It is used to look inside the esophagus, stomach and first part of the small intestine or the duodenum. And it is also referred sometimes as the upper gastrointestinal endoscopy, because the first part of the small intestine, that is the duodenum, esophagus and stomach, are observed through the procedure called gastroscopy. Okay. Before going on to the remaining questions, if you are here for the first time, please do refer Agape Vlogs questionnaires in test 1, 2, 3 and 4. This is test 4, continuation from questions 31 to 40. So moving on to question number 32, which of the following can a patient not have if they have a pacemaker in situ? Options are option A, MRI, option B, X-ray, option C, barium swallow, and option D, CT. So what is the right answer? Right option is option A, MRI. Question number 33. In a fully saturated hemoglobin molecule responsible for carrying oxygen to the body's tissues, how many of its hemoglobin sites are bound with oxygen? Option A, 2. Option B, 4. Option C is 6. Option D is 8. The right option is option B, 4. Next question. Question number 34. Which of the following is not a cause of type 1 hypoxemic respiratory failure? Options are option A, asthma, option B, pulmonary edema, option C, drug overdose, and option D, granulomatous lung disease. Right answer is option C, drug overdose, or otherwise called OD. It's an ingestion or application of a drug or other substance in quantities greater than recommended. The question was, which of the following is not a cause of hypoxemic respiratory failure? Hypoxemic respiratory failure means that you don't have enough oxygen in your blood. So pulmonary edema, granulomatous lung disease and asthma, they all are considered a cause of hypoxemic respiratory failure. So the right answer is drug overdose. Moving on to the 35th question. Prior to sending a patient home on oxygen, healthcare providers must ensure the patient and family understand the dangers of smoking in an oxygen-rich environment. Why is this necessary? Options are option A, it is especially dangerous to the patient's health to smoke while using oxygen. Option B, oxygen is highly flammable and there is a risk of fire. Option C, oxygen and cigarette smoke can combine to produce a poisonous mixture. And option D, oxygen can lead to an increased consumption of cigarette. Option B, that is oxygen is highly flammable and there is a risk of fire, is the right answer. Just using your common sense will give you the right answer. Question number 36. Before that, let me tell you that in all of the series I have done, I have included critical questions in it. So don't skip any of the questions. Question number 36. What action would you take if a specimen had a biohazard sticker on it? Options are option A, double bag it in a self-sealing bag and wear gloves if handling the specimen. Option B, wear gloves if handling the specimen. Ring ahead and tell the lab the sample is on its way. And option C, wear goggles and underfill the sample bottle. And option D, wear appropriate PPE and overfill the bottle. Option A, double bag it in a self-sealing bag and wear gloves if handling the specimen is the right answer. There are a few more questions in this video, so don't quit. But I want to remind you to give me a thumbs up if you found this video useful. Now let's continue. This is an important question. Question number 37. What is the best way to avoid a hematoma forming when undertaking venipuncture? Options are option A, tap the vein hard, which will get the vein up, especially if the patient has fragile veins. This will avoid bruising afterwards. Option B, it is unavoidable and an acceptable consequence of the procedure. This should be explained and documented in the patient's notes. Option C, choosing a soft bouncy vein that refills when depressed and is easily detected, and advising the patient to keep the arm straight whilst firm pressure is applied. Option D, apply pressure to the vein early before the needle is removed, then get the patient to bend the arm at a right angle whilst applying firm pressure. So what's the right answer? As a nurse, I really know nobody will get it wrong. So option C, choosing a soft bouncy vein that refills when depressed and is easily detected, and advising the patient to keep their arm straight whilst firm pressure is applied. So even though you know the answer right, you should also tick it right. Okay, so there lies the point. Next question number 38. Hope all of you are getting your answers right. If you are not getting to, don't worry. Please keep hearing Agape Blog's questionnaires repeatedly while you're sitting and relaxing in your room and all. You can hear over and over the questions and answers so that it gets registered and there's no chance for you getting wrong. Question number 38. This is an important question. Listen carefully. It's a pretty long question as well. You are caring for a patient with a history of COPD who is requiring 70% humidified oxygen via a face mask. You are monitoring his response to therapy by observing his color, degree of respiratory distress, and respiratory rate. The patient's oxygen saturations have been between 95% and 98%. In addition, the doctor has been taking arterial blood gases. What is the reason for this? Options are option A, oximeters may be unreliable under certain circumstances. Example, if tissue perfusion is poor, if the environment is cold, and if the patient's nails are covered with nail polish. Option B, arterial blood gases should be sampled if the patient is receiving more than 60% oxygen. Option C, pulse oximeters provide excellent evidence of oxygenation, but they do not measure the adequacy of ventilation. Option D, arterial blood gases measure both oxygen and carbon dioxide levels and therefore give an indication of both ventilation and oxygenation. Definitely option D, that is arterial blood gases measure both oxygen and carbon dioxide levels and therefore give an indication of both ventilation and oxygenation is the right answer. Question also is very important, so try to understand. Question number 39. When using nasal cannulae, the maximum oxygen flow rate that should be used is 6 liters per minute. Why? Options are option A, nasal cannulae are only capable of delivering an inspired oxygen concentration between 24% and 40%. Option B, for any given flow rate, the inspired oxygen concentration will vary between breaths as it depends upon the rate and depth of the patient's breath and the inspiratory flow rate. Option C, higher rates can cause nasal mucosal drying and may lead to epistasis. Option D, if oxygen is administered at greater than 40%, it should be humidified. You cannot humidify oxygen via nasal cannulae. So what's the right answer here? The right answer is option C, that is higher rates can cause nasal mucosal drying and may lead to epistasis. Epistasis is nose bleeding. So I think you have got the answer right in your mind. Okay, now let's move on to the last question of the series. So going to the next question, let me ask you, have you selected the bell icon next to the subscriber button so that you get notified whenever I do make a post. Okay, the most important question in this session, question number 40, you are currently on placement in the emergency department, that is the ED. A 55-year-old city worker is blue-lighted into the ED, having had a cardiorespiratory arrest at work. The paramedics have been resuscitating him for 3 minutes. On arrival, he is in ventricular fibrillation. Your mentor asks you the following questions prior to your shift starting. What will be the most important part of the patient's immediate advanced life support? The options are, option, listen carefully, option A, early defibrillation to restart the heart, option B, early cardiopulmonary resuscitation, and option C, administration of adrenaline every 3 minutes, and option D, correction of reversible causes of hypoxia. This is a very important decision to be made by you as a nurse. So the right answer is option A, that is early defibrillation to restart the heart. The patient is supposedly said to be blue lighted into the ED, that is blue lighted means someone when taken to the hospital in an emergency vehicle using blue flashing lights. That patient is with a suspected stroke should be blue lighted to the nearest hospital. Okay, that's now let me share some vital points. That is, most adults who can be saved from the cardiac arrest are in ventricular fibrillation or pulseless ventricular tachycardia. Okay, so why is it important? Why is early defibrillation so important? Defibrillation, it reverses the cardiac arrest by sending an electrical current through the heart muscle cells, momentarily stopping the abnormal electrical energy and allowing the normal heartbeat to resume. So greater than 50 to 70% of sudden cardiac arrest victims survive if defibrillation occurs within the first 5 minutes. So here ends our session. Take care of yourself. I hope this session has been very informative and instructive for you. If you found it beneficial, do share with your friends. By hearing to all the questionnaires multiple times so that you can crack the exam wherever you are, in a very easy manner. You can spend only 2 minutes for every question. So take care of yourself. Bye-bye.